Hi, I'm Wendy Stuart, and you're listening to Loose Lips.
Hi, Tim.
Hi, how are you, Ike?
Oh my God, happy Pride.
Happy Pride. I never would have guessed.
Yeah. Oh, I know. This is the thing I found in the closet.
This old thing.
And how fast we put it together, right? Well, I'm Ike Avelli.
And I'm Tim Moss.
And everyone's listening to
Loose Lips.
Ooh, Pride Lips for sure.
Yes, Loose Pride Lips.
I know you're really busy this week, Tim.
Oh my God. Oh, it's been amazing. It's been incredible. Yeah. I've just so much going on Pride, which I'm so happy that it's back. You know what I mean? I just now got back from the Bronx LGBT Expo where I performed and did interviews and stuff like that. It was wonderful. Just so nice to see people again and to hug them and to be in the same room.
It's and how so was everybody like more relaxed? I mean, with the no masks.
Everybody was pretty cool. You have a couple every now and then, you know, that are like, you know, are you vaccinated? Are you, you know, and which is fine. You know, everybody's got to have their own thing, you know,
Their own thing.
And got to deal with it their own way, which is fine. Yep, and we have to be respectful of that.
But what a difference from last year.
Yeah, right. Oh, my God.
Everybody was doing Zooms and StreamYards and
out
and about for Pride. It was sad.
Yeah. So how are you doing, Mr. Pride?
I am good. I am good. I got to see you last Friday night.
Yes. Well, and our guest was there, too. We'll talk about that.
Yeah, absolutely. And then I'm seeing you more than ever. I'm going to be seeing you this weekend. And
oh, I got you now.
Well, Tim, guess what?
What?
Our show is sponsored by Uberlube.
No, really? I love Uberlube.
And especially during Pride.
Yes. Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't need as much as I used to, but.
Well, I still do. Even not during sex, okay?
Yes, you can always use it on your hair to get your added sheen.
Yes, and people can visit uberlube.com and check out all their amazing products.
I love Uberlube. They are incredible.
I agree.
Yeah.
We're just going to get right into it without the Uberlube today. So we just want to tell everybody where they can find us. You can hear us on Saturdays on iTunes. You can ask that little bitch Alexa to play us.
Yeah.
Amazon Music, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Pandora, iHeartRadio, and everywhere your heart desires.
I was going to say, where else? Where are we not? We're everywhere. I love that.
Yeah, lift up your toilet.
But also, we've had so many wonderful listeners tuning in from like Decatur, Georgia, Maryland Heights, Missouri, Germantown, Tennessee, Norwood, Ohio, and also Dublin, Ireland, which I love.
I know.
And also our fans who visit every single week in Clichy, France. Ooh. I don't know if I said that close. Cliché? Clichy, France.
Clichy.
Because I love French.
Yeah. Oh my God. A man with a loaf of bread.
Yeah. And a French accent. I'm all yours.
Amen. Like I said, Tim, we're just going to bring our guests on because we have so much to
talk about. Oh, God, yes. Absolutely. Oh.
So our guest today is a model, author, producer, actress, activist. Her larger-than-life personality wouldn't let 2020 stop her from being creative. So she came up with Pandemic Cooking with Wendy and has over 100 episodes under her belt. You can catch her currently with her incredible co-host, our Tim Moss, live every Wednesday at 2 p.m. from Pangea with their show, If These Walls Could Talk. Mm-hmm. You could also watch her with Stephen Bloomer Teague on Triversity Talk, a weekly series that tackles all the pressing issues in the LGBT community.
Yeah. Now, also, she wrote an incredible book called She's the Last Model Standing, a fabulous memoir, and it covers it all. It's like from fashion and entertainment to like stories of all the jobs she had to make sure her rent was paid. I love it. And she studied anthropology. voodoo in Nigeria. And now that New York City is opening back up, she's already back on track, attending events for Imperial Court of New York at the Stonewall Inn and just many, many others. She is all over town. She is a dear friend. She's like my sister.
Yes.
Please welcome the fabulous and glorious Wendy Stuart Kaplan.
Yes. Oh, my gosh. Tim, I'm so happy to be here. Happy Pride, boys.
Happy Pride.
Pride.
Cheers.
Cheers. Do you like my hair? Do you like
it? I love it. It looks like you had it done.
It's Uber Lube. It's amazing. There you go.
Amazing, right?
Yes.
A little bit here, a little bit there.
That's right.
A little dabble to you.
Tim, you don't even need as much as you used to. How did that happen?
I'm too busy outperforming and not performing, if you know what I mean.
Oh, wow. I kind of figured that that's where you were going.
It's
with
the
that.
Natural ability that he has.
Oh, natural. So how are you all doing tonight?
We are good. We were just talking about how we just seen you Friday night at the Asylum in New York City.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I love when we meet at the Asylum. Both those great jackets.
We have a little reunion at the Asylum.
A little reunion at the Asylum. And we all know. For anybody listening, the Asylum is a wonderful theater that I just discovered. Did
Me
you
too.
Know it's right. there? Where is it? 28th between
26th, I think. Yeah.
Between
26th and 8th Avenue.
8th Avenue, yep.
A really great theater, and of course, we saw Camp Morningwood, which is
a naked gay musical. The actors are naked, and we fortunately got the front row seats.
We literally went from a year of no dick to a night full of it.
Just like this with penises.
We knew somebody. That's how we got those front row seats. Yeah. You know what, you guys? I have to tell you. The show was so funny and so well written.
It was.
From the dialogue to the songs. Yes. The music was wonderful. Yeah. I didn't even notice that they didn't have their clothes on. We all have this thing about nakedness, right? And I didn't even notice it. After like the first.
After a while.
After the first ding dong.
Dong, dong.
But I honestly think. My favorite song was Everything's a Dildo If You're Brave Enough.
I
mean, how absurd. And they came out with giant dildos.
Yes, it was perfect.
It was so funny.
I've got mine right here.
It's kind of small compared to the ones we saw that night.
That was a little rough. Yeah.
But I had such a great time and it was wonderful. You know, we're all performers going there and supporting other performers who were on stage for the first times themselves, you know?
Yeah. Because I'm so glad you guys joined me because I had hosted that night. I hosted their after party. And I got up and spoke before the show and then after the show and performed and stuff. But I'm so grateful that you guys came because we had a ball. Firstly, the three of us are together. We're going to have an incredible fun time.
Inevitable.
But the week before, our good buddy Jed Ryan
had
hosted. Yes. And oh my God, Jed, I just love him.
A shout out. We all love Jed Ryan.
Yay.
He was a stellar example of a human being. I had him on Triversity Talk. And we got talking about, you know, the first time I met Jed, he didn't have clothes on. Okay.
No. Typical.
Probably typical. But a lot of people could say that. No, but he was in a show. He was doing burlesque. Jed's burlesque so much cooler than a lot of other people's. There's such a sense of humor to it. It's like vaudeville.
He actually puts like a production value into it.
Right.
He's got so much going on.
Right. There's always something squirting and he's opening something. There's all kinds of things going on, but he's become an incredibly dear friend. And we hit a level at the show. You know, we have been laughing about burlesque and Jed not having clothes on and who's hot and who's not. And I said to him, what was the pandemic like for you? You came to my house to shoot Pandemic Cooking 2 weeks after those wards were filled. What was it like for you? And he had an emotional crack at that moment.
Uh-huh.
I did too, because we all have to remember, you know, we all have that crazy, zany, loony side.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Lord knows, comedians, how do we deal with the tragedies in life? We deal with comedy, right? But that was, you know, that was the reality. And what impressed me so much about him, and I'll say this on any show I'm on, he got out there every day. He worked 12 freaking hour shifts.
And he was a nurse on the front line of this. Mm-hmm. When we didn't have all the information on it, he was right there with his hands on.
Yeah. Thank you. I got, you know, he would tell me how full the wards were. He would tell me if the numbers went up, because you know what? We weren't all getting clear information. No. So what person did was so above and beyond, and he is forever in my heart.
And you know what? That's such a good point here, because you know the first responders, they were going constantly. They didn't have time to process.
Yeah. Right.
Exactly.
Right.
But not only that, you know, that what they were wearing, Jed, I asked him if he needed masks. I was getting KN95s from a friend to give to nurses. They were in the same mask for 2 weeks. Not only that, he's coming home to his husband with that, though, you know, that had virus all over it. Mm-hmm. There was a whole protocol that you had to do about walking in the door and everything going. And no one talks about that.
No.
Right.
Really incredible. Mm-hmm. Yep. And although we are all moving into a new world right now, I never want to forget that, because that's formed me who I am right now.
And I don't think we're going to forget it for a very long time. I mean, it's out there. People are still wearing masks because they're cautious. They don't know if there's another variant. And, you know, you're reading things on the news, and you're reading things in the papers.
The thing is that we're not, a lot of people think, oh, it's over.
Right.
It's not over yet.
No. It's not over yet.
We're well past it. We're well past it. We still have to kind of proceed with caution, or just kind of keep an eye out. But
we have to definitely keep an eye out. But how cool, right, that we're actually going to have Pride this year.
Yes.
Not a formal, you know, Heritage of Pride March. We're going to have a lot of other things, and it's loose, and it's free, and it's what Pride was when it first started.
Exactly. Yeah, and sweetie, I'm telling you, I am popping all over this
city.
I love it, New York Pride, Tim Moss.
Because the thing is that a lot of organizations were like, because they couldn't get clearance or event permits for June, because June was still kind of closed. Well, then they kind of, June hit, and it started opening up and all of that. And everybody started going, okay, let's do our event. Let's do our event. Tim, can you host? Tim, can you sing? Tim, can you?
Which I'm
grateful for, but oh my God.
You know who Tim is? Tim Moss is a first responder for gay pride.
Yes. Amen.
We need to get some putts and pins, clang them together.
it is true. You know, it is true, because you're thrown into something that you usually plan for 6 months.
Exactly.
And now it's like, poof, there you go. Do it.
Right, right. Oh, sound. He muted.
I think you muted Tim.
Tim?
There we go.
And
and the thing is that we're not used to being back out and running around endlessly like that anymore. Right. And it's exhausting.
Right. Yeah.
Well, it's so much fun. It's a good type of exhaustion.
Well, yeah, you just performed for the Imperial Court at the Stonewall Inn. Now, that was your first time on stage for a year now, right?
It totally was, because everything I did this year was virtual.
Right.
I was on your show a number of times.
Yep.
And for me to take myself and have to crank it out virtually, that was a big mental leap for me. But you know what? I did it. We all did what we had to do. But I got to tell you, my first shot out of the bag being on that stage at Stonewall, which I performed on before. Stonewall stage is a magical place for me. Yeah. My best friend, Sweetie, NYC, who a lot of people know, who passed away, who was supposed to die in 6 months after getting a cancer diagnosis. We kept Sweetie going by doing shows upstairs at the Stonewall. And I can feel that in that room when I'm there. And then when I had my book come out, She's the Last Model Standing, Sweetie did a whole launch for me upstairs in the Stonewall. So that's a very sacred space for me to be able to do this wonderful show with the Imperial Court. And you all know, throughout the pandemic, you don't even know all the things I never wrote songs before. All of a sudden, I am able to channel parts of myself that I never could. Yeah. I've written all of these parodies, and I want to put something together called Songs of the Pandemic. Ah. So I did one of my parodies, Vaccine, which is like Jolene.
Yes.
You got the drift.
I love it.
And to be able to do that up there, and you know, I freaking forget the words. This makes me so, because people like us have so much in our heads.
Memory.
It is. And Tim, you know this. I was agonizing the whole time. And I thank God I had the sheet with me.
You're muted again, Tim.
Oh, I think he wants me to talk. Maybe he doesn't know he's muted. I'm going to go like that. Yeah. He's too. Anyway.
He's still
muted. My mic
is
unplugged. I'm going to switch mics. You guys talk amongst yourselves.
You can switch mic. You've switched mic to Paul, to Peter, to Rob.
He wants one like mine.
You want a big mic. Like I want a mic like Ike.
I want
a mic. Oh, my God, that's great. Let's do it. Let's write something. Ike's mic. I'm free spirit channeling right now. There you go.
But my question is, because I talked to performers, Wendy, during the pandemic, and they started to get a little bit of, you know, stage fright, because they're thinking, oh my God, when I get back on that stage, am I going to be able to interact with the people? Am I going to be funny?
Not even a little bit.
Not even a bright.
No, because you all know me. I have, for lack of a better word, an overbearing personality, whereas it's huge. And it is not everybody's cup of tea, but it is who I am.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
To be on that stage and have all those people there and the energy that was in that room, and Chauncey Dandridge, who we love to death.
Yeah.
I mean, brilliant producer, DJ. Now he's got an album out. I didn't even freaking know he made albums. He is so incredible, and he was there. That room had so much love in it, and all of the people that are my friends or my tribe, I should say. It was so great. It was absolutely a magical moment. I loved every minute of it, and I couldn't wait to get up there and do my parody.
And then the worst part is, and I feel like this all the time, is when you get up there and you get that moment, I need it again.
We all have that addiction.
Yes.
And here's the deal. If you can't feed the monster, like during the pandemic, all of us, everything that we could. Yeah. But a lot of people just wonder. But in our case, we had to keep feeding the monster. It's like Little Shop of Horrors. Feed me. Because we need it, right? You need to feel it.
Mm-hmm. Sure do.
But one thing you had mentioned about, like, your fear of forgetting the words, and you couldn't remember the words.
I did
a taping the other day, and I did Cabaret, which I have sang since the 1970s. Yes. I've sang this song. I totally blanked on the second verse. I had to literally we had to stop taping. I had to pull the lyrics up on there for me to get the second. I was like, oh my God.
It's a horror.
It's so weird. Yeah, that's like my worst fear, you know.
We all used to do poppers. I sometimes wonder. It's like nobody knew in those days when you were doing poppers, you know. Well, you know, it smelled like a dirty jock strap and again buzz. But you know, maybe I don't know, maybe we all lost. There we go. Thank you, Ike Avelli. But I don't know. It just does. You made me feel better, Tim, about like the word thing. And that's why I went up there and like, fuck it. You know what? I have the lyrics written down, which I had not only memorized, performed a whole bunch of times by myself. I do think, and you'll know this as performers, if I could have gotten into that space that afternoon, you know, when you do a run through, if I had done a run through, it probably would have been okay.
You know what though, Wendy, I got to be honest with you. It happens to everybody. When Tim and I were traveling two years ago, I rewrote the Copacabana lyrics from Barry Manilow. But I changed it to whatever venue I was at.
Right.
And I was up there and I'm singing, I'm like, where the hell am I? I literally said it out loud because I'm like, I forgot where I was at.
You forgot the venue you were at, right?
And I couldn't get it. I'm like, where am I in prop? Where am I?
What city? I mean, couldn't come up with the city. Nothing.
Yep,
that happened.
Completely withdrew.
Right. So you know what? This is something that happens. The show must go on.
Yeah.
No matter what. But you know what? I loved doing the lip sync with you too, Tim, to Something Bad. That was the Tim show we did for the Imperial Court. It was called Barnyard Duets.
Yes.
And when they presented it to me weeks ago, I'm like, what the heck am I going to do? And they sent me, they said, maybe you can do this. And I was thinking, who would be great to do that with me? But Tim was. Like, we were two cheap floozies.
Blondes
that got into trouble all the time. Ooh, something bad. Something bad was
something
really good.
It's coming, yes.
Yes, it was just, so much fun doing that. And I love thinking. Although even with that, we had the words on the computer.
Yeah.
This is all, the story of my life.
And,
you know?
And writing it yourself, that's the worst part. How did I forget what I wrote?
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. To vaccine? Yeah, how could I have forgot that?
Yeah, it happens.
But that's the thing. Yeah, your mind gets moving in other directions, and it's very easy to forget lyrics.
Right.
Meanwhile, I can remember Mickey by Tony Basil.
Sending me.
But you do so many things. Oh my God, yeah. I'm curious. How did the modeling come about? Like, how did you start modeling? Was that something you always wanted to do?
Yeah, so good question, Tim. My mother had been fifth runner-up in the Miss America pageant. And I grew up in the Bronx, but I knew I was meant for more glamorous things in life. And I would watch her line her lips in front of the mirror with a red brush and then fill it in with red lipstick. Yeah. And throw her mink on and go to the Associated supermarket.
Yes,
I love it.
She gave up back in those days, right? She married my dad. She gave up everything to be a homemaker and have kids. I grew up in a 4-flight walk up in the Bronx. But that glamour, I remember her sitting in front of a gorgeous dressing table. And she told me what that dressing table and all her mahogany bedroom furniture when she was on her lunch hour from a modeling job with, I'm glad you're sitting down. Shirley Schrift, who was Shelley Winters.
Yes.
And Lucille Ball.
Oh my God.
It was like this in the day. Her name was Shirley Schwib. My mother was booked with one.
Wow.
Went out and bought that bedroom furniture on her lunch hour. So I had all of these scenarios in my head as a kid. There were two things, and I tell this to everybody. I knew I was going to be a model, and I knew I was going to go to Africa.
Yeah.
And in my family, you know, where my mother wanted me to go work for, she always said, you should go work for the phone company or become a teacher so you have something to fall back on. She didn't want my dreams crushed. I now understand where that was coming from.
Yeah.
However, this is a big life lesson. Every child should be allowed to pursue their dreams. Look at the three of us.
Yeah.
You know,
this
is what we want. So I envisioned myself as a little kid that I was going to be a model. And Tim, the irony of it was I went to my first model agency when I was 15 and they said by myself, my mother wouldn't even help me. And she said, I don't want this for you. You'll do something more stable, easier.
Yeah.
And I remember putting on mascara, coats of mascara, until my eyelashes were totally pointy. And I had on this little gauze, like, you remember when all the Indian fashion was very in, like back in the 70s, you know, it was very hippie stuff. I had on like a hippie dress. And I remember getting off the train on 59th Street, bitterly cold winter day, the mascara flaking into my eyes, the dress blowing between my legs and sticking, all right, my hair in a million directions. And I go up to Ford Model Agency and I saw two models that were there and they looked like real models.
Yeah.
Cheekbones, gorgeous, you know, just thin, real thin. I was like always 10 pounds overweight. And they looked at me and said, can we help you? I said, yeah. I said, I'm interested in becoming a model. And the receptionist looked at me and she said, where's your mother?
Oh, no way, because you were so young.
I know. And I said, well, I'm here by myself. And she said, are you in school? I said, well, yeah, of course. She said, how old are you? I said, I'm 15. She said, when you graduate high school, come back. But that was just a way to keep putting me off.
Yeah.
And I graduated high school and I went back to Ford, to Stuart, to Zoli. It was always the same thing. The biggest rejection I had was, to this day I remember, the angles in your face don't match the angles in your body. What the fuck does that mean?
Oh, my God.
It's as if I was putting a head on my body.
Yeah, right.
But here's the deal, you guys. I just kept going after it. All right. Yeah. Went away to college. Mm-hmm. My college boyfriend took these pictures for me. I came back to New York City, turned down by every model agency once again. 21 mm-hmm. years old, couldn't get arrested. Started going to Studio 54 and got with this little agency that gave me a list of photographers. And they were famous, some of them. Back in those days, you could knock on someone's door and say, "Do you do test shots?" And
right.
they didn't charge for them.
Wow.
And doors I knocked on was at 7 East 20th, and it was Alan Kaplan. And there he was with my crummy photographs. He invited me in, and I'm like, "Oh, Alan Kaplan, he's a very big photographer." And he looked at the crummy pictures I had, and he said to me, "Can I give you some advice?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "If I were you, I'd get a 9-to-5 job and get out of the business." But then what? This is my dream. This is what I want to do. And he said, "You need to have some money. You're not going to make any money as a model right now." He said, "I will help you out. You know, I think what you're doing is incredible. I'll take some pictures for you. And then you can try going to Europe and see if you get anywhere there." And the rest is history. And that's how
it's done.
And I've been doing it, you know, I've been doing it forever. I will tell you, and I do share this freely whenever I'm on a show, it is a hard business, now harder than ever, because mm-hmm. they can crank out girls. They have access to girls all over the world. Mm-hmm. And what used to be longevity of a career, for me, I'm still doing it because I have found every niche in that area. Yeah. But for most of these girls that get picked up by the big agencies that get covers and everything else, which mm-hmm. I was never one of those girls, those girls are chewed up and spit out within 3 years.
Yeah.
You better take the money and run. Okay. I've been fortunate. I have landed in an area called fit modeling, where, you know, I try on clothes for designers, and I'm simplifying it, but I tell them what measurements to make their clothes to make them fit their customers. Mm-hmm. And people will pay for that skill. It's a skill, you know, especially now. I mean, Lord knows we're coming out of this pandemic. Listen, everyone was in their sweats for like 5 months. 15 months is a long time to be wearing Lululemon. You know what I'm saying?
True.
Lululemon can you wear?
Well, I want to ask Wendy. So Alan Kaplan. So what year was that you met him?
So that would have been 1976.
Wow.
I've known him long. But we didn't go out till way after that. You know, I was engaged to an Orthodox Jewish dentist.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow. Well, my book, that chapter is in there too.
Yeah, yeah.
Jane Newhouse. And he was a lovely guy, but he was making me, he didn't practice any Judaism, except he'd go to his parents on the Jewish holidays, you know, to like show his face.
Yeah.
But he made me go through an Orthodox conversion, which I miserably failed at. Yeah. I couldn't do it. I mean, hello. You know, I was walking to synagogue in a blizzard because you're not allowed to take public transportation.
Right.
I'm getting pelted with ice and snow because you can't carry an umbrella. And I was supposed to have Shabbat lunch with people I had nothing in common with. While I was doing that, he was eating cheeseburgers and snorting cocaine. What's wrong with that?
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I know. Finally, it was like, you know what? I think it was Yom Kippur. I lost it.
Yeah, hung in there until Yom Kippur.
Yeah. Yom Kippur, when I got into a huge fight with him, I remember throwing pots and pans at him. And that was I was so hungry.
That is so cool.
But Alan and I were always like the best of friends. And then in the 80s, all of our friends started dying. I mean, it was unreal those times. Yeah. And it's left me permanently scarred. I will never deny it. It had everything to do with me becoming an activist. Alan too, you know, all our whole world, we weren't like allies that played in a straight world.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Well, Alan's best friend lived with him. He was a flaming, amazing illustrator, Manning Obregon. He took care of Alan before I came on the picture. And Manning was a better wife to Alan than I'll ever be. Socks and underwear out to the dry cleaners. They would come back. I don't even know what it cost. It was a fortune. They come back with tissue in between them and everything. He took incredible care of Alan, but it was, we were losing all our friends, and the straw that broke the camel's back for us. Manning had this plan. He was helping all these straight male models, you know, achieve their career because he was very well placed in the modeling industry. And he kept saying, I don't need to worry about AIDS because, you know, I bring in all these boys from Indiana and Utah. These boys, none of them are going to have AIDS. Well, you know, that proved not to be the case. And he passed on the couch in Alan's studio. Which was devastating. But after that, we really went into activism 150%. We joined an organization called Powers. We took care of the pets of anyone that had HIV or AIDS. We had a huge loft and we gave fundraisers there. And we would have the clients come. The bad part to that, once again, I mean, I've had such tremendous loss. Of course, Wendy became friends with all the clients because a lot of them were very sick, but they were the same people I would have been friends with 10 years ago before the virus invaded them. And they every single one of them passed, except for the few that we were able. We were able to get, there were two doctors that were doing what you call the Dallas Buyer Club drugs or the preliminaries to the cocktails. They were not giving people AZT. They were doing experimental stuff. One of them was Joseph Sonneben, bless his soul, amazing. He's still with us, incredible what he did. And there was another doctor called Larry Higgins. And we would, on occasion, get people into those doctors. I would say most of those people are alive today because I have been through it.
Right.
And, you know, when people say to me, why are you so hardcore? And goddamn, don't call me an ally. It's like, for me, it's a freaking insult. Yeah. I have been in the belly of the fucking beast when they were slipping trays under the door at St. Vincent's Hospital and went because they didn't want to touch or come in contact with that person in there.
That breaks my heart seeing those people that were they were able to survive, you know, the ones that got through and then the ones that didn't. It always breaks my heart.
But so many, and I always say the first round of it, it took the brightest and the beautiful.
Yeah.
It really did. I've never seen anything so viciously cruel and bizarre. AIDS was bizarre to me and will always be bizarre to me. Yeah. I have to tell you, this little humdinger that we've just come through, COVID-19, bizarre. Two things that are bizarre.
In our lifetime.
Yeah.
Right. Two of them in our time. Like, it's enough already.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What have we learned from all of this? So, I choose in adversity to try and pay it forward. And, you know, it brings me to now and who I am now. I just got a great write-up in Get Out magazine.
That's
amazing.
And what I'm so happy about, because I've been interviewed by lots of magazines, and when I get into my activist Wendy stuff, I don't know, you know, and you guys will understand this. Lots of times as a performer, people want like a shiny little thing that's not going to cause adversity.
Exactly.
You know, performers are expected, don't rock the boat. Oh, thank you for casting me in the show. I'm so happy. I'm going to send you postcards every week.
Right, okay,
That's the world I came out of. So now I am loud and outspoken about this. There's been so much stuff that came down the pike in the last 4 years, anti-LGBTQ legislation, really singling out the trans community. Now,
right out of the gate,
you know it. So for me to have most of that article devoted to what my agenda, it is my agenda. It's a good agenda. Yeah.